Any questions?
Coach, can you talk about the spark that Billy gave you guys in the second half?
Yeah, I mean, we were looking for a little bit of consistency, and you know, we didn't play as well as we're capable of playing that offense, and you know, we were just trying to get a spark. And fortunately, we've got some really good quality depth at the quarterback position. He was scheduled to play, you know, right from the get-go, so it wasn't anything that was surprise. And we went with the hot hand, and you know, he provided the playmaking and did some things with his feet, did some things with his arms, and you know, just gave us enough good plays to get out of dodge.
What went into the decision to start Ryan instead of
Billy? Just, again, we knew both were going to play. We just got into a little bit of semantics of how much each one was going to play. Both have really good camps. You know, and I think even the third kid, Andrew Holland, had a terrific camp. So it just got down to a feel in terms of everything. But we feel that position, you know, until we get Kiefer back is very, very solid. And I thought the kids, you know, played hard. We made some mistakes, as two freshmen will. You know, basically, Billy's a freshman. He's a redshirt freshman. Becker's a freshman. You know, so he hasn't played in a couple of years since high school. So, you know, we'll have some growing pains, but obviously, there's some talent, and hopefully, we can just continue to get better. Yeah.
I'm a French reporter.
Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Claire. Yeah. You came to know a few weeks ago that Owen Thomas was suffering from brain disease. So I'd like to know what was your reaction when you heard about that, and also if you guys are not afraid now to go on the field and play.
I was a little bit surprised. None of us knew that they had requested his brain to be tested. So when it came out, we were a little bit caught off guard, didn't have much notice in terms of trying to notify our kids and everything. It happened on a Monday, which is our day off, so we had to really email and text our kids that the article was coming. I mean, I don't think it's affecting anybody either way. Obviously, it's something that people need to pay attention to, but I don't think it affects the way we play or the way we practice or anything else. You know, hopefully it's something good will come out of a tragic situation, but you know, from our end, it really didn't change anything.
And you guys, do you think of that? Are you afraid to do you think of that?
Personally, I heard the news and I don't really think about it at all when I'm on the field. I mean, if anyone, my mom heard about it, said something to me and was concerned, but, I've played football most of my life and it's not something you can really think about when you're out there, so.
It was shocking news to everyone that was kind of a factor in what had happened to Owen, but just like John said, we've been playing this game since we were young, and it's kind of just like second nature now. It's, once you step on the field, nothing else really enters your mind.
John, I counted 25 helmets in the huddle before the last play and the timeout there. Can you just talk about what was said in that huddle
before
the last play of the game?
Well, we have lots of different personnel that go on the field based on what they come out with. So, pretty much the 2-deep comes out to the huddle, talks about what's going on. And then once we saw they came out with, I think it was 4 or 5 receivers, and we just sent out that our corresponding personnel. So, nothing really special about that. Yeah.
I guess this could go for any of you guys, but what were you guys thinking of during that moment before the game?
It was tough, you know. We all woke up this morning, watched the piece on ESPN, brought back a lot of the feelings from April. But, we came out, we really just wanted to play for Owen. We came out with a mission tonight. I think, overall, I think we responded pretty well, given the circumstances.
When you guys went into the locker room at halftime trailing, was there any mention of any of that stuff in terms of trying to rally around it and play and get the win for him, or was it strictly football?
You know, I think a couple guys definitely mentioned it, but, you know, we play Lafayette, and the past 2 years that I've traveled, we've been down 17 or 24-0 at halftime, so we were down 8. You know, we were really panicking too bad. We knew if we could keep playing solid defense, that our offense was going to get it done for us.
Billy, that touchdown to give you guys the lead, it's a beautiful pass. What did you see on that play, and was that one of the best passes you think you've made, or where does that rank for you?
Definitely here is my best pass. But that was a great play call. I mean, we were running the ball really well the whole game. And for Coach McLaughlin to call that pass, trusting me and trusting Matt Tootin to make that catch, that was a big play for us at a turning point in the game. And after that, we kind of got into a little groove on offense, and we were able to move the ball pretty well.
Al, at halftime, you'd given up one first down, and you were down 8. I mean, did you feel like you were...
First game, Mike. Crazy things happen in the opener. I mean, just really do that. And we have some young kids. You know, again, we talked about the quarterback situation already, both really being freshmen. We had some young kids at running back, you know, who were either sophomores, you know, that they were playing at running back. We had a first year, in the first game, snapper. You know, we have a sophomore punter. It's the first game. And it was the first half of the first game, you know, which I think makes it a little bit more well than really than what you'd like it, but you gotta kind of withstand the storm. I think the kids did a good job of that. And you know, we slowly got control of the game against a pretty good football team, and you know, at times we dominated, and it was just really shooting ourselves in the foot to make it as close as what it actually was. But we knew they're a good football team, and we knew they had a game under their belt, and we knew we've had really close games with them. So any win right now is a good one. You know, you can always correct the things that we did.
John, you mentioned that you've lost a couple of road Lafayette. Is there any sense of you know, trying to get these guys that you don't want to go out without because they won three in a row against you and all.
Right.
Was there any sense of, you know, a little point to this as a way to end this?
Absolutely. I mean, my senior class really didn't want to go out having lost these guys 4 times in a row. And, you know, that was just another factor going into the division two today. So, we definitely had a lot of motivation.
Sean, 3 picks today. Have you ever had a game like that in your life?
That's a personal record. Going back too far.
Tell me you go to Atlantic City. Yeah. If I want, right about now. Just buy one for me. So.
Can you talk about some of your interceptions, what you saw in those plays that you made?
On the first one, I was playing man-to-man, the tight end, and I noticed that he was in an ineligible number, so I was basically just kind of a free player, and they were dragging the guy across the field, and I just dropped underneath it, and the other two were just deep balls. We talked about becoming the receiver when the ball's in the air, and you know, just tried to put myself in a good position to make a play, and you know, came down with it. So.
Coach, after the offseason you've been through, how important was the actual outcome of the game to you, or was it
I think it's obvious it's important. I mean, we're on the verge of, you know, that 800 win milestone. It was a game, you know, we were trying to pay tribute to Coach Lake, Steferi, and Owen. It's your opener, you're at home. You know, so there's a lot of tangible things that you want to play for. We knew it was going to be hard. I mean, I'm not at all surprised at how hard it was. If that's probably the way this series has gone the last 3 or 4 years. And, you know, I think the biggest margin of victory is maybe 4 years ago, the last time we won was like 21-11 or something. So it's maybe 10 points. That's been the largest margin of victory. So it's been overtime, it's been 2 points, it's been 7 points. So we knew, you know, they're a good football team. Yeah, so we knew we were in for 60 minutes, and it literally went 60 minutes.
So, Coach, like you said, it's been a lot of close games, a lot of games that have come down at the very end against Lafayette in the last couple of years. So, but given how the defense have played and how dominant they've been all game, when you guys took the lead after that touchdown pass, how confident were you that you guys were going to hold on?
Well, you like to think you're going to continue to, you know, play well. I mean, there's no reason to think that we weren't going to play well. We put ourselves in a scenario where it was more than a field goal to tie the game, which I thought was big. And so it gave us an opportunity to get after it a little bit, because even if we give up a little bit of real estate, the clock is going to run and everything else. So, you know, I thought our defensive kids played great. You know, I thought we were not as consistent on offense as we need to be. And we had the typical first game kicking mistakes that, you know, if you go back and you watch Lafayette, you know, play last week and fumble punts, and it's the first game. It's crazy things happen. 2 balls get kicked out of bounds. I mean, that's what happens in the game, and luckily everything happened in that kick-wise in the first half, and kind of got things straightened out.
Before you took the lead, you had a 4th down there in your territory, in Lafayette territory, rather. and you could have kicked the field goal, take the lead. You decided to go for it. Mm-hmm. Billy ended up converting on the sneak, and what was what went into that decision to?
I mean, it was going to be a 42-yard field goal, and you know, I mean, Andrew's certainly capable of making it, but I figured I didn't want to put it on just one kid. You know, I thought we were running the ball well. I thought our offensive line, you know, was playing well. I thought our backs were playing well. So, you know, I wanted to put it to all 11 guys. I wanted to show them confidence that, you know, we're going to take some chances. We're not going to be afraid to. And we took two or three fourth down opportunities. You know, and I think it's the confidence I have in the kids. And so, luckily, it worked out. You know, if it was a little bit closer, it probably would have been, you know, a little bit easier decision to make to kick a field goal.
For any of you guys, this is obviously your first game back, so a lot of this game wasn't about paying tribute, but once the next game comes and then you're going to have a game every week, do you think it's going to start? I know it'll never be the same, but do you think it's going to start kind of returning to normalcy and feel like other seasons?
I hope so.
I don't know. Return to normalcy, it's always going to be different without Owen this season, but, you know, We've really used that as a purpose, you know, rally cry. It's not a, you know, we haven't really hung our heads at all about it. You know, we miss him every day, but, you know, we decided the best way to pay tribute to him is dedicate the season to him. So it's not just one game. It's, you know, it's tonight and the next 9 weeks.
During this 40-second challenge, go through your head.
At the end of the game?
No, before the game.
Oh, before the game. You know, I was just thinking back to, you know, good memories of playing with Owen. He's a wild man. He's a, you know, great kid, great friend. I thought that was a really good gesture that they did that. You know, I think everyone was just pretty emotional, you know, 40 seconds. But
whose idea was the 40 seconds?
That was collaboration between multiple people and us at the moment.
Thank you.
After everything that's happened, did it feel good for you guys just to get out and actually, you know, play the game, even coach the game? I mean, was it a relief to be out there?
Yeah, I mean, we had no scrimmage this year, so we've been killing each other for 29 practices. So it was really good when we saw somebody in a different color uniform.
Yeah.
Anybody at this point. So yeah. I thought it was a huge relief. We were certainly ready for a contest. Without question, it's a long preseason when you have nothing to break it up with an outside scrimmage or anything. So, it's tough.
Thoughts on joining that Elite 800 weight club?
Yeah, I think that's tremendous. It's so hard to do. Kind of testament to the tradition and the history that Penn has had. I mean, you know, there's probably 6-7 other schools that have done it collectively. So,
ten. Pretty good names on the list.
Yeah, there's some pretty good schools, and that's a pretty good fraternity to join. So I think it's a wonderful accomplishment for all the people before us. And it's just nice to be part of something so special. I mean, it's really a big deal, and hopefully it's treated like a big deal because there aren't very many people in that fraternity.
Anything else, guys?
Are you expecting to continue to rotate at quarterback and in the backfield?
I mean, you got to look at the film and everything, but my, you know, without looking at everything, I think it's in our best interest. We got young kids. We're trying to develop them. We're trying to get them some game experience. You know, we've been a little bit scarred from last year when we had so many quarterback injuries. So we're trying to develop a little bit of depth just to make sure that we have depth right across the board, whether that's a tailback. If you go back 2 years ago, it was the year of the tailback injuries. You know, we have two or three of those guys now. So we're really trying to make sure that we have some quality depth that people in the game that can function and run the game if needed.
As far as Kiefer, do you have any sense right now of whether he'll play next week?
It'll be week to week. You know, again, we're not going to rush him back. You know, I want him healthy. You know, I want him feeling good about everything. You know, I want him, you know, just in his own mind to make sure that he's 100% ready. And until I feel that, there's no reason to rush him back. I mean, it's Villanova, and then we'll talk about if he doesn't play against Villanova, we'll talk about, you know, whether or not he'll be ready for Derby.
Does any part of you want him to get some experience before the Ivy League season starts, or would you feel comfortable going into
it? Well, again, it's going to be as much medically driven as anything else. So it's not a question of do we want to play him, not play him. it's a question of when he's ready, then we'll make those decisions. He's right now not ready. He may be ready for next week, he may not, but we're not doing anything until he's 100% ready.
Okay.